In today's tutorial, we're gonna practice how to draw rocks with pen and markers. These are 5 examples I will work through in this tutorial. I will briefly talk about the basic shapes and the fundamental shading at the beginning of the video. Then we will practice coloring different sets of rocks one by one. You can find the art supply list in the description box. If you have any questions, feel free to leave a comment. If you already know how to render a basic cube with markers, feel free to skip this first part. You can find the timestamp in the description box. In this tutorial, we're gonna take a look at one of the easy ways to draw rocks. I will show you how to transform a basic cube into a rock. First, let's practice drawing a cube and add the basic shading. You will need 2 or 3 shades of gray markers for the shading part. By using 3 shades of markers, we will be able to create a range of value, including light, mid-tone, core shadow, cast shadow, and reflected light. The cube we are drawing has 3 visible faces. This will be the basic form to guide us to draw the rock later. I like using the chisel tip for the coloring. Oftentimes, make sure your marker strokes follow the direction of the plane. For example, use vertical strokes on the vertical plane. The light source is from the upper left. Use the lightest shade to color the top plane, which has the lightest value here. Use the second shade of the gray for the mid-tone, then the third shade for the core shadow and the cast shadow. Each plane will have its own light to dark value. Add a more darker value on the upper part of the vertical surface. Because of the reflected light from the ground and the contrast effect, the lower part of the vertical surface will appear lighter than the upper part. To make it look like a stone texture, you can simply draw some dots on the surface. When you are moving your markers towards the bottom part, you can lift your marker a little bit at the end, so the lower part will have a lighter value. Having 3 shades of gray is helpful to create enough contrast among these 3 sides. Later when we draw rocks, these 3 sides and 5 values will be our basic guide. By adding the basic shading, we have created the illusion of depth. By using the same technique, we can draw an irregular shape of block. Remember, you will draw this shape with 3 sides. You don't need to draw perfect straight lines here, but make sure your lines are fully connected to each other. When add shading, make sure each side has its own light to dark value. Most of the time, I don't draw back and forth to blend the marker ink together. I like to leave the stroke mark as it is. Unless I only have 2 shades of markers, but try to create 4 different shades, then I will draw back and forth to get more ink on the paper to make it look darker. Since we have 3 shades of gray here, we don't need to apply so much pressure on the paper to draw. Instead, apply less pressure first to get a lighter shade, then gradually apply more pressure on the paper to add a more darker value. We are going to use the shape of this block as an outline to draw a rock. Grab your pencil and sketch a block, which has 3 visible faces. Each face is formed by 4 straight lines. Now follow the direction of each line. We will draw some intersecting lines to add more planes on each face and create a broken edge. These are some lines and strokes I normally use to draw a rock. There are many different types of lines you can draw. I like moving the pen fairly fast to get a straight and sharp line. In addition to shading, you can use the line weight to create a depth in a drawing. For example, I add more thickness to the line that is closer to the viewer. To add irregularities on the edges, you can draw a discontinued line like this. In this way, compared with the block we drew before, this rock will have more varieties on the sharpness of the edge between each plane. The surface of a rock is uneven and bumpy, so we need to add more variety on the shading. These are strokes I normally use when add shading to the rock. The light source here is from the upper left. Start with the lightest shade of the gray to color the top plane first. You can simply leave the area that is closer to a light source white. Then use the same marker to add some light value to the front plane. The front plane is darker than the top plane, but it also has its own light to darker gradient. When we were drawing the cube, we talked about the upper part of the vertical plane appears darker than the lower part because of the light reflection from the ground and the contrast effect. Same rules can be applied here. As you are moving your markers, lift the marker a little bit, so the stroke will have a shading gradient. You can use a gel pen to add a few highlights and cover some mistake you made. Notice when I render the cube and the block, I use the long marker strokes more often to create a smooth surface. But when rendering the rock, I use short strokes more often and don't mind the overlapping marks. They help you to get a variety on the shading to create an uneven texture. After the marker ink is dry, you can add a more darker value on the upper edge to add more contrast between each plane. Now we finish the basic shading, you can use a pen to draw a few more lines to add some texture. Following the same steps, we can draw a group of rocks together. We can use the triangular composition here. Start by drawing three different blocks that have different heights and widths. Make sure each of them has three visible sides. You don't have to follow the form of three sides block all the time. Following this simple form is just easier to build up the depths. Now, following the direction of each line, add the irregularity on the edge. Let's briefly talk about how to add shading. So we already practiced basic shading at the beginning. We will use the same formula here. The tricky part could be the value variety on each major plane. We have three major visible planes for each rock, but each major plane will have some subplanes. I roughly outlined each subplane here in the picture. The shading could be complicated compared with a single rock we have drawn before. But just remember, keep everything simple. The simple rule is planes that are closer to a light source will be brighter. Start with the lightest shade you have. Add some light value first. Leave some areas that are closer to a light source white. I like using curved stroke on the top plane to make it look like having an uneven surface. Switch to the second shade of the gray to add the midtone value. You don't need to evenly add shading to each side. Remember, each side has its own light to dark value. And the upper edge of the vertical plane will be darker than the lower part. But it depends on the lighting condition and the surrounding object. Switch to a third shade of the gray to add the core shadow. I often start to draw from the upper edge and move the marker downwards while lifting the marker a little bit. So the upper part will be darker than the lower part. Normally, your marker stroke can simply follow the direction of each major plan or subplan. Sometimes it doesn't really matter because the ink will blend and you won't see the direction of the strokes. But being consistent will help your drawing look more cohesive at the end. I only have drawn a few strokes by using the third shade of the gray. Then I switch back to the second shade of the gray to add more mid-tone to each rock. If you use the darkest shade of the gray to shade the entire plan, the overall drawing will be too dark. The darkest value should be the cast shadow and the cracks. You can use the yellow marker to add some warm tone on the top plan, so the lighting will look more interesting. Now, following the marker stroke, I'm using the pen to further define the shape of the subplan and add some cracks and veins. The cast shadow is still not dark enough, so I will do some hatching to add the darker value. Now this drawing has a basic range of value, but still don't have enough depth because the cast shadow faded after the ink is dry. So use the third shade of the gray to add some cast shadow on the ground and between each rock. When the cast shadow falls on the body of the rock, make sure the shape of the cast shadow follows the shape of the rock. Now you can use a gel pen to add the highlight. Sometimes if I need to lighten up some small spot, I will use a correction pen. You can use white color pencil as well. This is the final look of this drawing. When you are ready, let's move to the next practice. This time we will draw a group of rocks on the water. Follow the same steps, sketch a few blocks first. We will draw rocks that are more rounded this time. The rounded rock still has different major plans, so sketching the basic block first is still very helpful. This time we are getting rid of all sharp angles, use curved lines instead. We will get rid of the middle vertical lines as well. The ink outline is fairly simple. We will add more details by using the color. This rock has a more rounded form. If you have brush tip markers, you can definitely use a brush tip. Most of my markers do not have the brush tip, so I like using chisel tips more often. I feel like the brush tip will create a style that is more like a watercolor painting. By only using the chisel tip, sometimes can add more styles to your drawing, depending on how you use it. So feel free to explore more ways to use your markers. To color the water, you will need at least two shades of blue. The darker one will be used to color the reflection of the rocks. The reflection doesn't have to look exact like the rock itself. When the water surface is not smooth, you will only see a wobbly shape. So just simply darken the area close to the rock without drawing too many details. You can add blue colors to the bottom edge of the rock, since this area is darker when it's soaked by the water. Add a little bit of color you used for the rock to the reflection. You can use a pen to draw some wavy lines to show the movement of the water. I added some hatching here to darken the reflection. The last step is using the gel pen to add some light reflection on the water. For the next practice, we're gonna draw rocks that have moss on its surface. If you want your drawing to be more precise, feel free to use a pencil to finish the detailed outline before you start to use a pen. We're gonna color the moss first. Just fill the moss with a light green first. Add some dark value to the lower right side, since the light source is from the upper left. The moss on the right side of the rock will have some dark value on the left side, because of the cast shadow from the rock at the center. Following the direction of the plan, I'm using curved strokes here instead of the vertical stroke. When you use a marker that has a medium shade of color, you can use it to create different shades by controlling your speed and strength. Add shading gradually by applying less pressure on the paper first. Use a darker green here to add some darker value, while drawing some dots and white strokes to make the moss look like having an uneven surface. Here we can draw some marks to define the edge of the moss. Once the first layer of ink is dry, you can use a third shade of gray again and apply more pressure on the paper to add a more darker value. Use two shades of green to color the grass as well. The bottom part should be darker. These little details add up will make your drawing have more depth. This is the final look of this drawing. The rest of the video will be the full process of how I created this landscape drawing by using the same technique. To do drawings like this doesn't mean you need to have lots of markers. I used about 17 markers throughout this drawing, and I don't really blend colors too much to get a smooth gradient when adding shading, because it would take lots of ink. I do leave quite a bit white space as part of the light value. When you do drawing with pen and markers, you can use both line weight and shading to create the illusion of three-dimensionality. Also, the object in the foreground will have much more details compared with the object in the background. In my previous tutorials, I have talked about how to draw trees, shrubs, and water. It's very helpful to practice drawing individual objects first before drawing a large scene. I like drawing individual objects first, then demonstrate how to draw a small scene with the same technique. I won't talk about how to draw a landscape scene in this tutorial to make this video so complicated. I will try to make other tutorials in the future to share more details. I hope you're enjoying watching this tutorial and have learned something. If you have any questions, feel free to leave comments. Thank you so much for watching. I will see you in the next tutorial.